You are listening to the Tricorder Transmissions, episode 26. And
now,
here are
Craig
and
Jeff.
Hello and welcome back to the Tricorder Transmissions. I'm Craig Cohen.
And I'm Jeff Hewlett. This week, we are talking about a particularly significant episode of Star Trek, Errand of Mercy, which is the first appearance of the Klingons.
Yes, and we're eventually going to devote an entire supplemental episode to the Klingons after we get a little bit more Klingon appearances under our belt. And I'm very much looking forward to that supplemental episode. But even more exciting this week was news and the publication of the latest issue of Star Trek magazine, which featured a 10-page article on Star Trek The Experience.
Yep. And it also featured two former guests on our show, April Hebert and Vernon Wilmer. So we were very excited to see that. More experience stuff from two of our friends.
Yeah, and it's very cool to see the official Star Trek magazine devoting a good bulk of their, you know, issue to talking about this, you know, great, great attraction that ran for 10 years in Las Vegas. So it was really exciting for me to see this when, of all places, Vernon posted it on Facebook. And actually, if you haven't gone to the Facebook page for Vernon's documentary series, do that. It's if you go to Facebook and search Star Trek My Experience, you'll find the page. And in addition to providing photos of the issue itself, Vernon has also published his section unedited, because apparently for the publication they truncated it and got some facts wrong. So after you pick it up on newsstands and read it, check out the Facebook page for a little bit more from Vernon about it. And I had a chance to read it, and there were some really cool things in it. In addition to April and Vernon's comments, there were comments from two of the guys that were sort of tasked with dismantling it, and they had some really interesting stories.
Oh, pretty cool. That sounds, I've yet to pick it up. I'm going to definitely make my way over to Barnes & Noble and grab a copy. So I was really interested to hear what your take on it was. And I'll say, for anybody out there who has read it and is tasting for a little more information from April and Vernon, our interview with them is still available on our website and iTunes. So if you want to hear them talk about their experiences, you can download that episode and check that out.
Yeah, it's the first supplemental episode we did. And I would dare to say that we have the definitive Star Trek The Experience interview.
Really?
I think so. Are there? We spent almost an hour or mm-hmm. an hour with April and Vernon talking about their time at the Experience, and you know, the history of the Experience. So it really, you know, I mean, nothing will ever beat Vernon's comprehensive documentary that he's actually still working on. But I think in terms of an audio interview that you can go on a podcast and listen to, I'm not sure there's another one out there that's as detailed as ours.
Yeah,
maybe I'm wrong.
No, I don't know. I want to agree, because I was very proud of what we did, and I think it came out really, really well, and so well, in fact, that we're going to be getting April and Vernon back on future shows of ours. So we're looking forward to having them back with us again. So unfortunately, Craig, this week, as we did last week, we have more sad news to report, though.
Oh, no.
Yeah, unfortunately, another Trek actress has passed on. This time, Sarah Marshall, best known for her role in The Deadly Years in Season 2. She portrayed a doctor, Janet Wallace, in that episode. And if anybody doesn't know which episode that is, it's the one where they get that that disease and they all get really old.
Okay.
Yeah, remember that one?
Yeah.
Yeah, so she passed away on January 18th after a battle with cancer. Born in 33, daughter of a couple British actors, and began her career in the 50s. Her film debut was in 58 in The Long Hot Summer, and her television career included a couple of shows that you might have heard of in conjunction with Trek and many that weren't. So My Favorite Martian, Donna Reed, F-Troop, Ironside, Get Smart, I Spy, The Fugitive, Remington Steele, and, of course, Star Trek.
Wow, what a a resume. So, and it sounds like she had an amazing career, and it's always sad to hear this, and my condolences to friends, family, and fans.
Yeah, it's a shame. I always hate to hear about these things, but
yeah,
you know. And did you, by any chance, hear about Takei's project, his documentary about his own life called To Be Takei?
No.
So it premiered at Sundance this week, apparently.
Okay, so it's made.
Yeah, yeah, and it's making the rounds, the festival circuit. So hopefully we'll get to see it soon.
Yeah, I'd imagine that it will be really interesting because he's got a pretty amazing story, you know, from spending time in the internment camps in the 40s, you know, right up to, you know, Star Trek and beyond, and even his, you know, post-Star Trek career and, you know, coming out as a gay man. So I'd imagine that's going to be a really interesting watch.
Yeah, I'm really interested in seeing it. So I was excited to hear that it's out there. So I'm hoping that in the near future, we'll be able to find it somewhere streaming, or it'll be made available for purchase.
I got to say that it's really cool that there's so much material out there based on, or, you know, created by the players behind Star Trek. I mean, if you compare Star Trek to Star Wars in terms of that, you know, look at how many biographies we have from cast members. Mm. You know, look at the amount of, you know, just general output that's related to Star Trek that we have from these people. And you don't really get it with Star Wars. Like, Mark Hamill never really wrote a book about his experiences on Star Wars. You know, it's interesting. And I think that's one of the benefits of being a Star Trek fan is how much out there. I mean, there's so many just documentaries alone that focus on key players from this series and key episodes and key moments.
Yeah.
So it's really neat. And this sounds like it'll be an interesting addition to the, you know, to the DVD wall.
Yeah. It's amazing that it's so many years past the original airing of these shows and how much information there is now about this stuff. It's a really great time to be an original series fan, isn't it?
Oh yeah. And I mean, even we've talked about the book, These Are the Voyages by, Mark Cushman, which is basically a book detailing each season of the original series. And there are facts and figures in that book that have either been misreported over the years or just weren't really known to the general public. So, yeah, it's always amazing when stuff sort of comes out that nobody knew.
Yep. I agree. And this is great. And it kind of feeds into a passion that I've had for years of delving into the backstories of actors and TV shows and musicians and bands that I love. I always love digging around and finding new books and interviews and, you know, outtake recordings and you know, screen tests and all that kind of stuff. So this is great that more and more stuff keeps coming out.
Yeah, yeah.
So, well, are you ready to talk about Errand of Mercy?
Oh, how can I not? We're going to see our first Klingons.
Yes, we are. So the original episode aired on March 23rd of 1967, and we had our remaster on May the 12th of 2007.
All right, and I have a write-up from the March 18th, 1967 TV guide, which I actually got from the season one version of These Are the Voyages.
Cool.
A peace-loving race gives Captain Kirk a lesson in warfare. The inhabitants of the neutral planet Organia hesitate to interfere in a war between Kirk's Federation and an invader until intervention becomes necessary.
Ominous. Ominous. Yes. So, awesome. So, let's count down to our scene-specific commentary starting in 3, 2, 1.
Pretty cool behind the shot there from the back, focusing on Sulu right away. There's a really strange thing that I noticed here. Watch, when Spock gets up and the camera pans out a little bit here.
Yeah.
Who's this guy?
Yeah.
You rarely see that position to the left of Spock on the bridge. And what is this device that Kirk has in his hands?
I thought it was a tricorder.
That is not a tricorder, sir.
Yeah.
That is some other weird looking thing that I do not recognize. Because tricorders don't have that semicircular handle on the top either. So I think he's maybe something for reading whatever that tape was that Spock just gave him.
Yeah.
So that was a interesting.
The thing, and I'm not sure how this would actually, you know, occur in real life, but one of the things that sort of bugs me about season one of this show, and we've talked about it before, is the ever-changing crew on the bridge.
Yeah, you know, there's a blue-shirted guy sitting next to Sulu at the console there in the, you know, quote-unquote checkoff position. You have no idea who this guy is, never seen him before, likely will never see him again. And I think Scotty's not in this episode.
No, I don't think we're going to see Scotty for at least until two more episodes from now.
Yeah,
I think.
City on the Edge of Forever, yeah. I think. Now, here's another interesting thing about this. This really bugs me. They're firing back at this Klingon vessel, right?
Yeah.
And they actually blow the Klingon vessel up using only phasers. Now, there'll be a bunch of debris floating here. And like, oh, we blew up the Klingon bird of prey using just phasers. Now, we've seen space battles happen, you know, in detail in some of the movies. And these ships take incredible amounts of damage before they explode. Now, here you're seeing floating debris. They maybe hit him with one or two phaser blasts, and the whole ship blew up.
Maybe they didn't have their shields up for some reason.
That would be really odd, but okay.
They kind of seemed like they were a rogue ship anyway.
Well, they were firing on the Enterprise. They wouldn't have been battle ready, and the Klingons are that poor of a warrior class that they wouldn't put their defenses up.
How did they break away from the rest of the fleet, though? They weren't like
I don't know.
They weren't like the Enterprise. That's, you know, just out and about. Mm-hmm.
Well, they're on this. They're doing negotiations, I guess, for this planet. They're trying to take over this Organia. They're negotiating for something or other here, and supposedly falling through. But it looks like we're gearing up for war, and it's Kirk's duty to deny access to this Organia planet. So we're gonna have to figure out a way to fight off these Klingons, who we know are going to show up.
Yeah, this seems like a little. Seemed like Starfleet was almost overstepping their bounds a little bit.
Yeah, for sure. Especially with some of the stuff that goes on down on the planet here in a few minutes. So that was the end of the stinger. Not a particularly great stinger in my memory. There's a lot better ones out there.
Yeah, I think in hindsight, it's cool because this is the first reference to the Klingons. So from that perspective, if you're watching this show for the first time, but you're aware of Star Trek and you hear Klingons for the first time, I'd imagine that you're going to, you know, pay a little bit more attention and be like, ooh, we're going to see some Klingons here.
Yeah. Well, you hadn't seen them before this. So you just hear the name, you don't know exactly who they are, what they look like. So you got a little bit of tension there as to what we're going to get when the Klingons actually show up, you know, kind of different than they did with the Gorn. You know, where you didn't really hear much of a name before they actually fought the Gorn. You only heard it a minute or two before he was transported down. But
yeah, so you know what's funny? I was thinking about the fact that every episode of Star Trek has a title, and that makes complete sense. Mm-hmm. And it's flashed on screen, and it just got me thinking about TV shows in general, where a lot of times you don't know what the name of the episode is, especially with sitcoms.
Until you go back to watch it afterwards.
You know, a lot of times it's not even on screen. You know, maybe in the TV listing you'll see it, or on DVD in the book they'll have it, the episode title printed. But I think it's kind of neat that it wasn't really something I thought about until this episode for some reason.
Yeah, I kind of liked it. So you see, Kirk was recording his log with a tricorder, so that was interesting.
Yeah, which is weird because we've seen that he has the ability to just push a button on
Yeah,
on the captain's chair.
I guess it really depends on who was writing or directing the episode.
Yeah.
How they pulled it off early on like this. But this is cool because Sulu wants to fight off, you know, the fleet of Klingon ships.
Yeah, Kirk's
on his own.
Yeah, Kirk's basically saying your order is
get the hell out of here.
You don't worry about us. And Kirk's taken that stance before.
Of course. Of course, but this is cool. He's leaving Sulu in charge.
Yeah, this is going to be one of the first.
Now, check this out. Yeah. They're beaming down, and notice how everybody's so courteous. They wait till they completely materialize before they walk into the scene.
Yeah.
There was nobody there until they're completely done, and then all of a sudden, and there's green goats.
I love the painted goats.
Yeah, what's up with that?
Yeah, I like
But they didn't paint their faces, though.
Yeah, there was somebody whose job was to paint those goats. That is a shot of a castle that still stands to this day in Haiti.
It's a stock shot, stock footage.
Yeah, right? From the 1800s. And if you go to Haiti, I'm sure if you looked hard enough, you could still find it today.
Yeah. So, and here we're seeing one guy decides to actually talk to them, even though everybody just kind of walking by and not paying any attention whatsoever.
He didn't really use his outside voice either, calling out to him.
No, he's kind of a little ways away, just kind of waving his arms around. Yeah.
Spock really sells the welcome gesture.
Mm. The United Federation of Planets. There we go again. Yeah. Another reference. Yeah, there. Yeah, Spock seems to be well aware of how to do this. And we're finding out they have no authoritative body. No one's in command of this settlement here. It's all just kind of everybody's just happy and living it up.
Yeah. Now, I want to get into some spoiler territory here.
Okay.
Were these people hanging out, waiting around for Starfleet and the Klingons to come? Because at the end of the episode, we see that they're sort of these, they're energy, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So the thing that I had a hard time understanding was, is this a civilization that it really existed, or did they set themselves up so they could teach Starfleet and the Klingons a lesson?
Well, I kind of thought that once they knew that, you know, the humans and the Klingons were coming, they just zapped this settlement into existence for them to have something to relate to when they came down.
All right, so it's basically just the Council of Elders are the only real members of this species.
Potentially, I don't know. Maybe all of the other people are members of it as well, and they just don't have any speaking roles. But I thought it was, the spoiler territory. I guess people, this is, you know, how old these episodes are. Yeah. I guess people have seen these before, so we shouldn't really pretend that people haven't.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, at the end, you see that they turn into these kind of spheres of light, which is, I guess, their real form. And I guess if Kirk and Spock beamed down and all you saw was a bunch of floating balls of light, you wouldn't have much of an episode.
Yeah, but see, that's the sort of the question I'm asking, though, is if that is all they were, what was the purpose of the Klingons taking control of this planet?
Trolling.
So you think the Klingons were just like, hey, here's a planet, we should control it?
Well, no, they said that it's a strategic position.
Okay.
The planet is in a very strategic place for what I don't know exactly, but I guess it's one of those places where, you know, you could set up a strategic supply route or, you know, a place for an outpost where, you know, to get to a place beyond this, the Federation would have to fly past it and be subject to attack by the Klingons from the strategic location. I don't think they really elaborate on what they would use it for.
Yeah, so it was less, it wasn't really related to conquering the people. It was more just taking control of the planet.
Yeah, and encroaching further into, you know, Federation space. Yeah.
I like the discussion they're having here where, you know, Kirk's, you know, sort of pointing out the danger they're in. And this guy knowing how this episode ends, he keeps repeating the fact, you know, that they're in absolutely no danger. And it comes off as naive here, but it's really arrogance.
Yeah, but you know, This is another thing in the line of things I've brought up in other episodes that kind of bother me, because here's Spock. He's been doing some scans and some studies, and he's going to come back. He's saying that this civilization that's here has not advanced at all in tens of thousands of years. So seeing all the stuff they've seen before they've gotten here and hearing how these people are just talking about how there's no danger, wouldn't these two be like, well, you know what? Maybe there's more here than meets the eye. Yeah. If everything in this settlement is exactly the same as it's been for 10,000 years, this is obviously maybe something artificial. Yeah. And maybe this is something that's just been materialized here for our purposes. And there's and these guys are saying, eh, the Klingons can't do any harm to us. And maybe you think, well, you know what? There's something else going on here.
Do you think that at least on Kirk's end, he was sort of blinded by or, you know, sort of feeding into the instinct for violence?
Potentially.
And, you know, that was sort of blinding him. There's really no excuse for Spock.
Yeah, well, that and Kirk's hatred for the Klingons, which builds in this episode. But he has some we're supposed to understand that there was some history already between the Federation and the Klingons, because they've already, they know what the Klingons are like. They're describing what living under Klingon rule is like. So obviously they know. And Kirk already has this this edge towards the Klingons. And now, here we go. The Klingons have arrived in orbit. And Sulu is sitting in the captain's chair.
That was the first time we see him in the captain's chair.
Yeah, very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. And did you know that Sulu calls them the Klingons? Not the Klingons, but the Klingons. And he does it twice in this episode.
Yeah, I guess there was no definitive pronunciation yet. I guess maybe it's sort of like T'Kai versus T'Kay.
Oh, good point. Good point. So now you're getting another little bit of a snippet here that there's something more to these people than you know. The guy in the red on the end there, he knew that the Klingon ships had appeared, and he knows how many Klingons appeared in the courtyard outside. Like he says several hundred men have appeared near the Citadel.
Yeah.
So they know. So they bring many weapons. See, and Kirk doesn't. How does he know that? Well, Kirk, you've been to tons of planets. You've met tons of alien races that blow your mind every week. You should know already that there's something else going on here. There's a telepathic. Some kind of obviously, if he knew who was over there and there's no telecommunications, there wasn't an intercom or something that said, there are Klingons near the Citadel, you know, and fade the commercial.
Yeah, now the funny thing, or not really funny, but sort of the plot device that was used a lot was not being able to beam back to the ship because the shields were up,
right? Yep,
now well, I don't know the science behind it, but it seems like. If you're breaking somebody down into matter and rematerializing them, are shields really going to make a difference?
I don't know, because they can fire phasers through the shields, right?
Yeah.
When the shields are up.
Yeah, it almost seems like it was one of those
plot convenience. Yeah, well, you know, the thing is, when you have... I've often thought about this, the geek that I am. I've often thought about... You have these technologies that make things really easy. Mm-hmm. Like, the transporter makes it really easy to get back to the ship. The communicators make it really easy for them to communicate over long distances or for even interplanetary. And phasers make it really easy for them to kill. So in order to make the stories more interesting, they have to disable these technologies, right? Because they're so overpowering.
Yeah.
They could just walk up and phaser anybody and boom, they're done. So they wind up having to make the phasers not work, or the phasers get taken away by some magical power, or, you know. So... And here we are, in walk the Klingons, and here is Commander Kor.
Yeah. It's John Colicos, who died in 2000 at the age of 71. And a fun little fact about him as actor, he was the last person shot and killed on the TV show Gunsmoke.
Wow. Another Gunsmoke tie-in with Star Trek. Yeah, I love the look of the Klingons here in the original series. I mean, we've talked about this before. In our extended episode recently about how the Klingons have the high foreheads and how that came to be and what the explanation was. But I think DC Fontana had said that she expected the Klingons to be a major recurring villain because they were cheap makeup-wise and costume-wise.
You didn't have to put ears on them. Yep. Or But the funny thing is there was really no clear-cut definition of what they were supposed to look like.
No.
So when Kor came in, he talked to Fred Phillips, the makeup artist, and he said, what do you want to look like? And John Colico said, I saw the script as a futuristic Russian and America at loggerheads over this peaceful little planet. So I said, let's go back in the past and think Genghis Khan, because Kor is a military commander ready to take over the entire universe with his hordes. My hair happened to be very short and combed forward, so I said, spray my hair, kink it up a bit, and give me a vaguely Asian tartar appearance. Let's go for the brown-green makeup so I'm slightly not of this world. And within 2 hours, this thing emerged, and that was it. And that was from an interview he did in Starlog magazine in 1989.
Oh, pretty cool.
And it's funny because a lot of the other Klingons in this episode just look like guys with makeup on.
Right.
Whereas here, it seems like
they put effort into
minus core. The forehead. You got the template of what the Klingons would go
and
on
even
to
the
look
outfit.
Like.
Yeah. Even the outfit with the sash going across the front. You know, it's a little it's a cheaper version of the Klingon outfit. But still, you see the disruptors that they have going on to later on in the series and other Star Trek series. They have the bigger, distinct-looking phasers, or disruptors, rather. So it's different technology, but similar functionality. And the Organians here are kind of just bowing down to the Klingons.
Yeah, and Kirk and Spock have assumed native roles. They're they're sort of disguised. So if the Klingons had come in and seen two Starfleet officers,
And I like how Kor respects Kirk / Boroner
for not having the dumb smile on his face and seeming submissive
and being slightly more defiant than the rest, which. Surprising to me that Kor doesn't realize that, you know, Kirk is not an Organian, right? I mean, you would think he's the only one person there who defies and thinks differently, right? And stands up to the Klingons instead of just saying, yep, we'll follow the rules.
And Kor is putting Kirk sort of in charge of being the go-to Organian.
Yeah, because he thinks he's the only person he can really communicate with.
Yeah, Kor said you can't trust a man who smiles too much.
I can see that. Yeah. Now they're agreeing again. Yep. We assure you that we want nothing but peace, so we're just going to kind of bend over and let you do whatever you want to do here. Interesting that this is one of very few episodes that does not have Dr. McCoy in it.
Oh, okay.
Very, very few. So you have this one. Take the two pilots out of the picture, of course. So out of the series proper, this episode, What Are Little Girls Made Of, and the second part of The Menagerie are the only episodes that don't have McCoy in them. So interesting. And, of course, no Scotty, as we already said. So pretty soon, I think we'll start getting to episodes where everybody is there and you don't have these bizarre absences.
Yeah, it seems like it would be hard to explain, you know, where some of these people disappeared to in season two and season three.
Yeah, really.
So, because I mean, they never went back home.
I love that sarcastic gesture that Kirk. Wade. Did you notice that they said take the Vulcan to the examination room? They got there 5 minutes ago. How do they have an examination room already?
Klingons, man. They're this probably isn't their first rodeo.
Yeah, but 5 minutes? They're like, you set up an examination room. So they just bust into some random villager's house and set up an we need an examination room. And beam down the brain scanner scrambler machine thing.
I love when he calls it the brain ripper.
Yeah, the brain ripper, the brain mind sifter.
So Spock has gone through the process that Kor explains would pretty much leave a normal man in like a vegetative state.
Yeah, and Spock's trained mind was able to resist and fool the system into thinking that he's actually this Vulcan
traitor. Yeah.
Oh, and this is, by the way, this is the last TOS episode where the term Vulcanian is used, from what I understand.
Oh, interesting.
So they say Vulcan a couple times, and one of the lesser Klingons calls him a Vulcanian. Mm-hmm. But it's the last time you hear that reference, from I believe. So here we're getting a little description here. Doesn't that technology sound a little too advanced for the Klingons?
Sure, they can capture every man's thought. So every thought that's gone through your head can be...
Yeah.
But I guess that's why it ultimately destroys you when they're done. Like, they haven't perfected the technology enough to...
Or they don't care. Yeah. Right? But I just thought it sounded like a little too, high-tech for the Klingons, because they're warriors. I mean, it doesn't sound like something that their scientists would really... Well, I mean, I guess if they take a lot of prisoners and they're trying to get information out of people...
Yeah, I can imagine they got tired of torturing people for information, and you can't... Ultimately, you can torture somebody to the point where they start saying the things you want them to say.
Oh, sure.
So they might have been like, hey, we need to find a foolproof way here to get inside somebody's head.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense, I guess. So, I don't know.
That's the great thing about Star Trek, though, is you can speculate on a lot of these little details.
We can endlessly debate these things. So from what I understand, there is a comic book put out in 2007 that told this same story from the Klingon point of view.
Okay.
Which is interesting. I wonder... I should look that up and see if I can grab a copy and... see exactly what went down from the other side. I mean, it might be interesting to see.
Yeah.
No? You don't sound very interested.
You know, it just... It doesn't seem like this story really presents itself from... it doesn't seem like the perspectives are that different. I guess you'd see that explosion happen and they don't know who did it.
Yeah. Well, maybe you'd see how they set up that examination room so quickly.
Yeah.
And how they're sitting there drinking tankards of ale at these... these little tables outside. They're a little bistro setting.
Yeah, see, these Klingons, they're barely Klingons. Yeah,
they're just dudes with brown makeup rubbed on their faces. That's all.
You know, I thought that they would have at least given all of them facial hair.
You would think.
Yeah.
You know what I thought was really cool, though, about this? Is that the second-in-command Klingon guy really tries really hard to act in this episode. If you hear how he talks, he doesn't talk like a normal person or even like Core talks. He talks kind of like this, sir.
Yeah.
Very staggered and talking like, he doesn't speak naturally at all. Like, he really tries hard to sell the fact that he's an alien.
Yeah.
He's not human. Whereas Core talks more like a normal person does. In perfect English, mind you.
Yeah.
Not in Klingon, in perfect English.
See, that one guy that walked by looked like he had, silver face paint on.
Yeah, maybe they ran low. They were on location, and they ran low on makeup. Mm-hmm. I love this random staircase on the side here. What is that staircase for? There's no railing whatsoever. It's just kind of a staircase.
Yeah.
It's so Kirk can jump off, and does it go anywhere?
Yeah.
And why does... I think this is one of those instances where... they didn't want Spock to do the nerve pinch more than once because he does it later. Mm-hmm. So I was like, why didn't he just run up, nerve pinch the dude, and that would be it?
Yeah.
It seems a little risky to have Kirk jump on the guy and try to knock him out with his fists, right?
Yeah. So what they're doing here is they're basically going to blow up the munitions as a sign to the Klingons that the Organians aren't going to sit back and let the Klingons do what they want. It's sort of they're just sending a message.
Yeah, and this is one of these things about Kirk that kind of bothers me sometimes, is that his behavior is so inconsistent. There are certain places where situations he's been in where he remains completely calm, and then there's situations like this where he can't help himself. Like he almost lashes out and punches the Klingons as they get into that altercation. The thing, he's blowing stuff up. he just can't help himself. Like, all he would just think, the Federation fleet is on its way. All he's got to do is lay low for a few more hours or so, or a day. Don't make any waves, and then the ships will all be there, and this all gets settled.
Mm-hmm.
He's not on his own. You know, they're undercover for the moment.
Yeah.
Everything's cool. You know, he could have just played the game for a little bit, but no.
It almost seems, though, like he's trying to teach this civilization that what they're doing is ultimately not the best way to do things, and that you don't have to sit back and sort of take what is, you know, given to you and, you know, offer resistance. And it almost seems like he's trying to alter this civilization's way of thinking.
Mm-hmm. Which is against the Prime Directive. Non-interference. But he's definitely interfering. Definitely. Mm-hmm. No?
I guess it seems like the Prime Directive, I'm not even sure I have a complete understanding of it, because it seems like along the way, things that seem like they would be in violation of the Prime Directive happen, and everybody seems cool with it.
I guess they only apply it when it's in the best mm-hmm. interest of Starfleet. Yeah. In this perspective, it's like, well, he's been ordered to not let the Klingons take control of this planet. So I guess it's like, well, you know, Prime Directive be damned.
Yeah. Well, I guess the Prime Directive would have been in violation here if the Organians didn't know that Starfleet existed. But apparently they're aware of that they're not the only people in that galaxy.
Maybe.
He welcomes them, so he knows that they're from off planet.
Well, of course.
Or does he assume they're from another side of the planet? So that's my only thinking. And I guess straight up giving them a phaser when they leave would be against the Prime Directive. You're giving them a technology that they don't already have.
Perhaps, because you're also trying to alter the course of their society by turning them into something that they're not. And if they're a peaceful society, you know, trying to force them to fight, that seems a little bit like you're pushing the limits there. Like if they say, you know, well, you know what, we'll let the Klingons take over, we don't really care. You know, who is Kirk to tell them not to let them do that? I mean, is that what they want to do? It's what they want to do. Mm-hmm. It's a selfish move on Kirk's part and on Starfleet's part, because they want to control that planet.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess you and I would think living under the Starfleet banner would be easier than living under the Klingon banner. But I don't know. Well, of course, they have their special powers that have yet to be revealed.
Yeah.
But I still think that Kirk's overstepping his bounds a little bit here.
I think what Kirk's doing, though, is he's sort of taking the Klingon...
drinking again.
The Klingon idea, you know, to its ultimate conclusion, whereas what would this planet look like under Klingon rule 10 years from now? And I think that's what Kirk's sort of, you know, getting to in his head is, yeah, today, you know, it's fine, but 10 years from now, what would this Klingon dictatorship look like for these people? You know?
Well, he has ideas, but he may not know for sure. I mean, these people are peaceful. Maybe they would get along fine with the Klingons. Maybe the Klingons, it would be a different type of colony. You know, the Klingons are used to taking over by force and, you know, having to whip people into shape and have them force them to do what they want. If these guys just kind of said, okay, we'll just do whatever you want, no big deal, the Klingons probably get really bored. I mean, Kor, as he said a couple times, like, these people are sheep. I mean, I have to govern a colony of sheep. You know, this is kind of a snoozer. Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, you got to think, you know, the Klingons are used to doing things one way, and this is kind of a different thing for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you have Kirk and Kor having what Kor, you know, deems a civil conversation, you know, before they get down to the mind ripping. The mind sifting or the unpleasantness. He just wants to sit down and talk to Kirk, you know, man to man.
Yeah, but, you know, this is a real interesting conversation, too, because this sets up a lot of pretext that Kor is aware of Kirk before he wanted to meet Kirk in battle. Mm-hmm. Kirk's name precedes him. He knows the name. Kor knows the name of the Enterprise. Kirk doesn't have to tell him the name of the ship. And they're having this kind of, you know, warrior to warrior sort of talk back and forth. But this sets up a whole history of things that have happened before this that we don't know about.
Mm-hmm.
So they're telling the audience that, you know, the Klingons are pretty well informed about who and what Starfleet ships, who's on the ships, who captains them, you know, what the names of the ships are. And, you know, even so much as knowing who the best Starfleet captains are, a.k.a. Kirk, and wanting to meet him in battle, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting.
Yeah.
That they set that whole thing up. Like, the other enemies that they have on the show, recurring ones like the Romulans, they didn't set up a heck of a lot of backstory, just the fact that nobody's seen them. There's a war, no, neither side has seen the other side. But they didn't have any pretext, like they knew, you know, who the commander's names were, what the ships were called, and all that kind of stuff. It's just, so the Klingons have much more of a close battle relationship, a close warlike relationship.
Yeah.
Kind of like we have on here on Earth when we're having, you know, relations with other nations here. We know who their leaders are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we know who their generals are. They know who our people are, I guess.
Yeah.
So, all right. Mm-hmm.
This episode was written by producer and writer of a lot of episodes, Gene Kuhn, and directed by one-time Star Trek director John Newland, who died in 2000 at the age of 82. But he's probably most known for a television series that he presented. He was the narrator and the presenter of a show called One Step Beyond that ran from 59 to 61 and can be best described as sort of like a more supernatural version of The Twilight Zone. A lot of people see him as the inspiration for Rod Serling.
Oh, that's very cool.
Yeah, and he directed a lot of TV, and he wanted to come back and direct more Star Trek, but it never really worked out.
Two questions.
Yes.
Korg gave Kirk 12 hours to make up his mind. That seems like a hell of a lot of time, doesn't it?
Yeah, you'd think it's a decision that you could...
Yeah. And number two, question number two, and this one's even more important. The Organians are peaceful people, right?
Mm-hmm.
Total peace. Why do they have jail cells? This is a pretty elaborate dungeon, too. There are multiple cells. They've got bars. They've got torches on the walls. This isn't something they just threw together.
Yeah.
And here he comes. This is the surprise. So now we have Aelborn has just waltzed right into this prison cell, seemingly, you know, no one's gotten in his way. He's somehow gotten past the guards or disabled them. No idea how he's done it. But, you know, he, after turning Kirk and Spock over to the Klingons and outing them, you know, destroying their secret identities, now he's coming back to break them out of jail, so to speak. And Kirk and Spock are understandably
skeptical.
Cautious.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this guy's basically like, hey, you know, we don't want to see anything bad happen to you.
Yeah, I love how Kirk says, you break us out so you can turn us in for the reward. Yeah, that's pretty good. Mm-hmm. So,
now, I didn't have a chance to look too far into it, but Kor pops up again, right? Not with this actor.
Animated series, yeah. I believe, is his next appearance. And I think he also appears in
DS9?
In DS9, yeah. References to, let me see. Yeah, references to this episode show up in a DS9 episode called The Sword of Kallus, or Kallus. I'm not sure how you pronounce that. I'm sure we'll get some feedback on that one. Mm-hmm. When Dax introduces Worf to Kor. So Kor, you know, and Worf and Kor have some conversations about how Worf was studying some of Kor's confrontation with Kirk and stories about this particular event. So this does reappear. And I believe Kor does show up on an animated series episode.
Yeah, I recall reading that.
Yeah. You know, I think it's really interesting about this, too, is during this scene, Kor, they already have, the Klingons already have a PA system set up here. There's no electricity, mind you. All the lights are candles on the wall or mm-hmm. torches. But somehow, the Klingons have a broadcast PA system with power.
Yeah. They've got, like, their own staging crew, I guess.
Yeah, man.
You know, that travels with them, and, you know, they put a quote together real quick, and...
They are, Now, Kirk says something really interesting here shortly. So the plan is for Kirk and Spock to get their phasers back, and they're going to go take on the Klingons The Klingons supposedly just killed 200
of the hostages. Organians, yeah.
Yeah. In 2 hours, 200 more will die. So Kirk decides they've got to take a stand. And yeah, he wants the Federation spies back. So they're going to get the phasers back. And Kirk is going to say something to the effect of, Starfleet has invested a great deal of money in our training.
Yeah, it's about time they got their money's worth. And
money is not something they talk about on this show very often at all.
Yeah, well,
especially not in that term.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like money is a necessary commodity for individuals.
No, but apparently it still costs money to train Starfleet officers, which is interesting because Starfleet is doing the training.
Yeah.
You know,
so where's the money coming from in a society that doesn't...
And where's it going? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, who are they paying? Themselves?
Yeah. It might as well be Monopoly money, right?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, because you see nothing. I mean, you have a couple of references in other episodes, like in
the Mud episode.
The Mud episode and in Devil in the Dark. They mentioned that they're mining and they're going to be rich men, right? Because of all the gems and precious metals they're finding. So money does come up every now and then, but they never seem to need it for anything. Like, they don't bring money to pay people with or any of that. So it seems like money is a foreign concept, but apparently it's used behind the scenes. All right, so there we go. There's the phasers are back and the communicators are back.
Yeah, and then Kirk basically says,
yeah,
I don't really like you guys, but it's still my job to protect you.
Yeah, I'm going
to
put my life on the line. We got no love for you people, but we're going to go try and take out the Klingon and stop them just to save you.
And it's basically insurmountable odds here they're up against.
Well, Spock is going to give us the exact odds shortly.
Yes. But even when they left, the Organian elders were like, hey, this is not a mission that you guys are going to come back from.
And now it's a very strange collective of these elders kind of staring at the door. We're seeing them talk, but we're hearing them talk, but seeing them from the back.
Yeah.
Which is a strange way of shooting that scene, isn't it? I wonder what the directorial decision was to do that. I wonder. So you recognize this? It looks familiar, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's where the Pike had to fight with the big brute in the cage.
Yeah, with the big mouthpiece in. Yes. Yeah, so 7,824.7 to 1.
Are there chances?
Are the chances of a little bit of humor here, of course. You know, Kirk is questioning the accuracy, and Spock is talking about how he endeavors to be accurate. So little touches of humor here and there.
Yeah. These outdoor sets were shot at the Desilu 40 Acres location. And I guess portions of what we're looking at show up in the 1927 film, The King of Kings. Oh. So,
now, why did that Klingon guy jump like that? He was shot with a phaser and apparently jumped forwards.
Yeah, you'd think he'd fall back.
Yeah.
And also, they were shooting their phasers at night. A pretty good distance.
Great marksmanship.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure how exactly the phaser technology works in terms of, you know, how similar it is to firing a gun. But that seems like that would be a pretty tough shot to take at night with, like, a handgun.
Especially since they're holding the phasers kind of at the hip almost. They're not actually holding it up and looking down a barrel.
Yeah.
And getting a, they're just kind of shooting from the hip.
Yeah.
So it might be a little bit more difficult to line those shots up. So here's this great second-in-command Klingon guy talking like a robot. So I love this. Kirk takes his rope belt.
Yeah.
And there's three guys walking past. He grabs one. The other two don't even notice.
Yeah.
No, he doesn't hear the guy going, or anything. That's the second-in-command guy, isn't it?
I believe so, yeah. And he wants some information.
Yeah, he's choking him out with that rope belt.
And you know what's surprising here? Spock's going to apply the nerve pinch, and it seems like the Klingon goes down real easy. We've seen scenarios where, you know, Spock sort of had to use a little extra juice, and you think maybe Klingons really weren't fully developed here where they had superior strength or...
Well, that's what they said when that virus or whatever it was that gives them the big rigid forehead and they turn them into brutes, right?
Yeah.
That's that link to Khan again. It's all Khan's fault.
Yeah. Now, do you think the Klingons, do you think they needed an explanation for why they look different? Or do you think that was just overthinking it?
I think it was overthinking. I don't think they really necessarily needed to define that. I mean, I think that everybody knew that this was the 60s and it was a low budget show and they just couldn't do that kind of makeup on a consistent basis, especially when you have like, you know, 10 different Klingon guys. They couldn't put that kind of makeup on everybody. You know, when the next gen came around, they had a little more money.
Yeah.
The makeup was, you know, time to do all this stuff. Even the motion picture when they first introduced the Klingons with the foreheads and everything, I think, I don't think they needed to retcon that, but I guess, you know, it was a topic of conversation amongst Star Trek fans for years, I guess. And I guess the Enterprise guys decided that, you know, DS9 made a joke out of it in the Tribble episode, but I guess Enterprise and its infinite wisdom decided that they were going to be the end all be all authority on how it got that way.
Yeah, I actually liked the concept that it was just like, hey, there's just like on Earth, there are several different races.
Yeah.
These are, you know, a different race of Klingon than we see down the line. You know, they're on the other, you know, other, completely other side of Kronos, you know?
Yeah, or they could have had something like, you know, the same time that the bigger Klingons were more the warriors, the soldiers, and these smaller guys were more the, you know, the starship pilots and stuff. You know, like the bigger guys were like the ground troops.
Yeah.
And these were the... They could have explained it a bunch of different ways, but, you know. I thought it would be kind of cool if they still had Klingons that looked like these guys on the other series. Like, they had them intermixed.
Yeah, that would have almost been an easier way to sort of address it. You know?
Yeah. Definitely.
And now we're basically getting the reveal here where there's attempted acts of violence, and everybody's reacting like they've touched a hot car door.
Yeah.
In the middle of the summer.
Yeah, man. I love how everybody on the bridge of the Enterprise really sells it. They all spring out of their chairs. Great. And here's our Organian friends.
Yeah, and they're basically saying, you know, we didn't want it to get to this. We wanted to give you guys the benefit of the doubt, but we've got to come in here now and, you know, put an end to your nonsense. And they're basically telling them that every instrument of violence, it radiates a heat of 350 degrees, and it's spread out to all of the fleet above planet as well. Mm-hmm. So,
well, and Aelborn says something really interesting. He says, "As I'm standing here now, I'm also standing on both of their home planets."
Yes,
which is really strange that this guy has the power to transport himself, you know, long distances away.
Yeah, and basically, everything he's saying on those home planets is a waste of time.
Pretty much.
Nobody comes away from this with a different opinion.
Nope. And it's funny, though, because there's a flip-top Klingon communicator.
Yeah, look at that.
That's interesting. And it's not the same as the Federation one, either. See how it's like a yellowish mustard color? Very different. First time you've seen one of those, and maybe the last. I'm not sure if you see one of those again. That same model, anyway.
Mm-hmm. And it's funny here. Kirk and Kor both sort of devolve to almost like playground type, you know, attitudes here.
Yeah, kicking and screaming.
They get very childish.
They do. Childish. You can't interfere. And I love how Kirk, it's like he can't control himself.
Yeah.
Like, you would think Kirk has seen these types of beings before that have these incredible powers. Yeah. Kirk's like, okay, wait.
Yeah, just cede to them. And
yeah, like, all right, you know, this could be Charlie X all over again. This could be Trelane again.
Yeah.
Let's just take a step back.
Yeah.
You know what? Let's let the Klingons argue and we'll be the more evolved.
Yeah.
But no. No, now they're going to argue back and forth, bicker and argue. And Kor doesn't... I think it's some sort of a trick, but it's not. And it's interesting because they'll even say, he's even going to say that the Klingons, he's going to predict that the Klingons and the Federation will be friends in the future and work together, which turns out to be partially true.
Yeah.
They're not totally you know, but they do come to an accord.
Well, yeah, you get to the point where the core representation of the Klingon government is you know, cooperative, and then you've got the rogues. That
you got the rogues, yeah. And you got Starfleet members who are Klingons. So you had a crew member on the Enterprise, Worf. You had them on DS9. You also had the Klingon girl on Voyager. Or was she partially Klingon, or was she full Klingon?
I think she might have been partially Klingon. I want to say she was part Klingon and part Romulan.
I don't remember what her other nationality was. I remember, I thought she was part Klingon because she didn't look as hardcore Klingon as, say, Worf did. She had the forehead, but she seemed kind of, you know, the rest of her face seemed pretty humanish.
Yeah.
You know, now, I thought this scene is funny to me because Kirk is he was telling the Organians that they had to fight, and now that they've decided, you know, they've enacted their powers to stop all of this. Now Kirk is saying, you know, how it's their right to fight, and how could they possibly step in and tell them they're not allowed to fight anymore? This is our war. We can have it if we want to, kind of thing.
Yeah.
Beings like yourselves. So now we're going to find out that they're much more evolved.
Yeah, they're yet another one of the species in this galaxy that, you know, were once like us and evolved to a higher state of consciousness.
Still waiting for that to happen.
And here they sort of turn into basically energy, balls of energy.
So let's talk about how that happens. So you're a corporeal being, right? You're a human being, whatever have you, and you evolve and you evolve and you evolve and you evolve. And one day you wake up and say, I don't need my physical body anymore. And then all of a sudden, boom. You no longer inhabit your physical body. Is that how it happens? I mean, did they have to invent some kind of a machine to free themselves of their body? If they did, how do they reproduce after that?
Yeah. I assume it was some kind of natural evolution.
That's what I mean, though. Naturally, what happened? Like, one of them's pregnant and gives birth to a ball of energy instead of a...
Well, I think maybe the mind advances to such a state that it no longer exists in the physical realm.
Yeah, but how does the mind leave the body then? How does that actually? What is the transformation that happens? Because it can't be gradual. It can't be half energy, half human, right? Or half.
Maybe they could have been. Maybe they started like looking like Marty McFly at the end of Back to the Future. Where he starts getting transparent, and then
or like one arm is energy, and the rest of them is still there. Like, you know, over 1,000 years or so, like different body parts start to become.
Yeah, as they become
like, hey, my foot vanished. I can't walk anymore.
You know, and all basically, you know, just, you know, develops, you know, from the light within you, and it sort of finds its way out.
Okay, we'll go with that. I like that.
I definitely think it's more of an organic process than, you know, stepping into a machine and having yourself reassembled as energy.
I guess so. Mm-hmm. Well, we're back on the ship. Everything's over. There's that weird guy in the blue shirt again. Who is that guy? So weird.
Yeah.
So we get a little bit of a wrap up here, but we are down to the wire. So we want to talk a little bit about our essential nature of the show. What are our opinions?
I think for me, the one and only thing that makes this an essential episode is the introduction of the Klingons. I don't think there's anything else on display in this episode from a character standpoint, you know, or any other reason aside from the introduction of the Klingons and the history that Starfleet has with the Klingons. Mm-hmm. For me, that's what makes this an essential episode. And it's also a good watch. So, you know, it's not like I'm recommending an essential episode that's kind of a bore.
True. Well, I agree. Definitely essential for the introduction of the Klingons and Kor, because Kor does show up again, so that's cool. And I think as a bonus, you get a little more insight into Kirk's hatred for the Klingons Because you see him later on in the movies, and he absolutely loathes the Klingons in the movies. And so much so that it's almost you almost kind of feel like it's slightly out of character for him to hate a race so much or a people so much at times. But I think that's something you gain a little knowledge of in this episode. So definitely another essential one for us.
Mm-hmm. That was a good point. I didn't even think about Kirk's sort of perspective. You'd think that, you know, on an earlier episode, we learned that Kirk sort of, in the Conscience of the King, you know, we sort of learned that Kirk had this, you know, incident in his teens,
mm-hmm.
you know, where he was part of a, you know, a group of people that were massacred or slaughtered or,
yep.
And you'd think that that would give him an intense hatred of, you know, the people behind that, you know, mm-hmm. I'm surprised nobody ever retconned that into it was Klingons.
Don't give them ideas.
All right, so I guess that brings us to the end, and I guess we'll be back next week to talk about the alternative factor.
I believe so.
All right, so I guess until then, thank you as always for listening, and if you'd like to interact with us or follow us or, you know, get updates or, you know, notifications anytime new episodes go up, you mm-hmm. can follow us on Twitter at @TTT_pod or Facebook at the Tricorder Transmissions.
Yes, that's it. And our website, of course, is thetricordertransmissions.com. So tons of ways for you to get all the Star Trek you want.
Yeah, and the cool thing about the website is there is a section there that you can go back and look
mm-hmm.
at the essential voting for each episode.
Yes, sir. So you can go down, if you hit the essential episode guide, you'll see a list of all the episodes we've done so far, and there's check marks next to each one. So there's a green check mark for essential and a red X for non-essential. And you can see how both of us voted.
Yeah.
And if there's two green check marks, the episode is essential.
Yeah. And we've got, I think, 4 consecutive essential episodes in a row now. We're 3 or 4. We've been in agreement for the last couple of weeks now.
Yeah. It's been pretty good. They're so far, I think the essentials have outweighed the non-essentials.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So far. But you can go on and you can see which ones we've disagreed on. Those are the interesting ones.
Yeah.
So we've agreed on essential and non-essential quite most of the time, but there are a couple where we were divided.
Split. And hopefully we hash that out and change some votes in the season 1 recap episode. But we'll deal with that when we get to that.
Yeah, well, not going to make any promises. But all right. Take it easy, everybody.
Welcome. I'm James Doohan. Our producer, Gene L. Kuhn, was hitting a creative high with Star Trek by this stage in our run. He followed The Devil and the Dark with Errand of Mercy, which is remembered because it introduced the Klingons. Kirk's counterpart in the Klingon Empire was Commander Kor, and when John Newland was signed to direct the episode, he immediately suggested John Colicos for the part. Colicos was living in Toronto at the time and remembers that the script arrived at his home about 2 hours before he was due to be at the airport to travel to Hollywood. He learned his lines on the plane and upon landing went straight to makeup, where Fred Phillips, our makeup artist, confessed that he really did not know what a Klingon was supposed to look like. Nothing in the script had given the clue. John explained that he viewed the script as an allegory of the Cold War between America and Russia. And with that in mind, Fred began experimenting with an Eastern European look for the character. Then, drawing inspiration from the past, John remembers suggesting that Kor be given an appearance which resembled Genghis Khan. His hair was already cropped short and combed forwards, and they decided to spray it black. Finally, they agreed that his skin tone should be brown-green to get away from a human complexion. All the other Klingons were then made up more or less around this basic pattern, and the Klingon look, which prevailed throughout the series, was born.